Welcome to Bio-Rad's Blackboard Training. This is a series of short, informal tutorials brought to you by industry experts. Today, we'll cover the basics of Six Sigma. Let's start with the basics. This is the lowercase Greek symbol for Sigma. You'll often see a 6 before it as a shorthand for Six Sigma. Six Sigma provides a convenient way to monitor the performance capability of a testing system. During the 1980s, Motorola set out to improve their manufacturing process so that virtually no defective products would be produced. Their process laid the groundwork that industry and clinical laboratories would follow. First, they set the tolerances for defects in their manufacturing processes that they were willing to accept. They then divided the tolerance into sigmas. A higher sigma score represents more efficiency. They then assumed a normal Gaussian distribution. Let's assume that they manufactured a million items. At 2 sigmas, it turns out that 45,400 defects would occur. That means that they'd have a defect 4.5% of the time. However, when processes are tightened up to 3 sigmas, the defects drop to around 2,700 per million. This is a defect rate of less than 0.27%. Here we can see the defect rate for additional sigmas. Notice how drastically the defect rate drops for each additional sigma. Let's focus on plus or minus 6 for a moment. You may be wondering why anyone would need to get their defect rate that low. Let's take a look at another curve to learn why. With all the variability in processes like production, it wouldn't be unthinkable that a shift in the process could occur. This could be in a positive direction or in a negative direction. Remember the defect rate for a Six Sigma process? It's so tight that something like a 1.5 shift in a process wouldn't impact quality that much. Unfortunately, not all processes are Six Sigma, and as sigma values decrease, the choice of QC procedures becomes increasingly important in detecting significant errors. So practically, how can we apply Six Sigma in the clinical laboratory? Let's begin with the formula. Subtract your bias from the allowable total error. Then divide by the coefficient of variation. We recommend viewing our previous videos if you're not familiar with the concepts of TEA, bias, or CV. The sigma value for a test is a good indication of its process capability because it considers both bias and imprecision. Unfortunately, most clinical laboratory tests are processes that are below Six Sigma. So, how is Six Sigma achieved? Well, the simple answer is to choose a test method with a Six Sigma process. Laboratories can take steps to control precision through proper training, instrument maintenance, and so on. However, to a large extent, method precision is a function of instrument methodology. While method precision may not be controllable, a QC procedure can be chosen that detects small changes in the testing system. This makes identifying defects easier so that corrective action can be taken. Minimizing bias is another good way to help improve your sigma metric. In conclusion, many labs review their sigma metrics for all analytes in order to identify good versus poor performers. This is done for continual improvement and for designing good QC management. We hope you've enjoyed this brief tutorial. For all of your QC needs, visit www.qcnet.com.